Please welcome Trevor Hughes.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon and welcome. Thank you all for joining us. I'm really delighted to be joined today by Kalinda Reyna from LinkedIn and Ruby Zefo from Intel. Maybe they can come out and join me. We are, of course, going to be talking about privacy. Ruby, Kalinda, come on out. Here they come. There we are. So good afternoon. We are going to be talking today about privacy. My name is Trevor Hughes. I'm the president and CEO of the IAPP, the International Association of Privacy Professionals. We are the world's largest privacy organization with almost 50,000 members in over 100 countries around the world. And two of the great leaders of our profession are sitting next to me here. Kalinda joins us from the company LinkedIn. She is the chief privacy officer there. She previously has worked at Nintendo and Apple in privacy leadership roles. And on my left, your right, is Ruby Zefo, who is the chief privacy officer at Uber, previously coming from privacy leadership roles at Intel. We have an incredible depth of privacy knowledge here on the stage, and I think it's fair to say that privacy is having something of a moment. You know, it is not a topic that we lack for material right now. And so during the course of the next 50 minutes or so, we want to have a pretty deep conversation about what's happening in the world of privacy, what we think information security professionals need to know. But we also want to engage you. And so unlike sessions where you leave questions to the very end, we're going to be taking questions throughout the session. And I think there are microphones set up in the aisles. With these lights, it's a little tough to see you, but I will do my very best. If you have a question, by all means, please approach the microphone. And if I don't recognize you quickly, please just wave or something, and we'll get to you as quickly as we can. All right. Let's start talking about privacy. So 2018, I think it's fair to say, was the year of GDPR, the General Data Protection Regulation. Many of you have heard of it. GDPR was a massive piece of regulation passed in Europe. And it was significant for a number of reasons. One, it was a brand new framework and architecture for managing data protection and privacy in the European Union. But two, within the GDPR was an extraterritorial application of that standard, which meant that any organization from anywhere in the world that had customers, users, citizens, people that they were touching in Europe was subject to that standard. As a result, we have seen many organizations, and I know Uber and LinkedIn have both spent a lot of time paying attention to this. A lot of organizations spent a lot of time last year making sure that they were ready for GDPR. At the IAPP, to just give you a sense of that growth, we saw our membership double in just about 20 months. So we went from just around 20,000 members to close to where we are now, just under 50,000 members in just about 2 years. That growth is a result of this issue exploding. So let's dive into that. Let's talk about GDPR and why it is such a monumental force in our space and what we know 1 year later. And maybe, Kalinda, you can start us off. May 25th was the compliance deadline for GDPR. We're about 10 months past that now. What do we know now? What's different, and what are we expecting in 2019?
Yeah, that's a great question, Trevor. And I think you're absolutely right in speaking about the ways in which GDPR was fundamental to shifting the conversation around privacy, not just in Europe, but here in the US as well, especially in the tech space. So if you're a company that's operating on a global scale, there's no way to avoid a discussion around GDPR and the planning that led up to May 25th. And I think since May 25th, what we've seen are some trends. We see regulators who have increased the number of inquiries that they've received across Europe. Data breaches are being reported at an all-time high. People are taking advantage of the rights that they have under GDPR, so the data subject rights. And so for those of us who built out programs to be prepared for May 25th, much of it is about continuing to maintain that operation and respond to it. So I don't think the work ended on May 25th. I think it has only just continued, and in some ways, we're really at the early stages of figuring out just how much more there's going to be as we move forward in a GDPR era, and what that is going to mean for privacy teams within companies.
That's great. Ruby, Kalinda just described GDPR as a bit of a journey rather than a destination, that May 25th was not an endpoint, but rather a starting point. Talk to us about that reality at Uber. I'm guessing that the work of GDPR has not ended, that you're continuing to build and develop. What does it look like at Uber?
Thanks, Trevor. So I like to analogize it to a baby. And I've said, look, you know, we waited 2 years for this baby to be born. The baby's here. You can't just leave it in its high chair to fend for itself. The baby needs to be tended to. Now, whether you think it's an attractive baby or not is up to you. The baby's here. So the interesting thing that I have found in my journey on GDPR is it started out probably like many other companies in the sense that we had work streams that addressed all the different tranches of it, and we worked to, you know, every tranche had to be attended to. And what I found as we went along, especially after I got to Uber, was, you know, this is what I view as a mature program. And so we stopped labeling it GDPR. We're still working away on all of those different controls and customer-friendly things that we wanted to do. But I think of it more as I want to understand the customer. I want a common platform from which we develop a good customer experience. So if you take your Uber, say you're here at RSA, you go get an Uber, but now you've had too much to drink, so you're going all the way to Vegas.
It hasn't happened, by the way.
It may be tonight.
No, you never know.
You have too much to drink. You're in Vegas. You don't want what happens in Vegas not to stay in Vegas. You want the same experience as you had in a very privacy-protective state like California. So we just changed the lens in how we looked at it. And as we know, since that time, we've had CCPA, which we'll talk about, other state laws. So it's spreading. GDPR is spreading its wings now, and it's covering more territory. So it's a good approach if you want a principled basis to a mature program.
Interesting. So, Ruby, let me stay with you. Tell me what surprised you the most about your GDPR efforts. What was the thing that sort of really stuck with you that was the most challenging or the biggest surprise as you were going through this effort?
One of the most challenging things was how when you look at it and you have different buckets of things you need to do, it's not that complicated to understand it. But when each bucket then has its work streams, and then those have its work streams, and you have this giant tree of streams flowing into the river, it's a lot. It ends up being a lot of tasks. And they all have to be coordinated so that you don't have somebody going off the grid or duplicative efforts or inconsistencies. So the challenge to making all that happen was real. The other thing is what to do about consent, right? Consent still plays a role. It's getting more difficult. If you're an app provider like we are, you have a leg up because you can give people knowledge real time when they most need it.
Sure.
But if you're not, like, it's very challenging to figure out how to get it right with the explicit consent required.
Interesting. Okay, so Kalinda, Ruby's just told us two of the biggest challenges that she experienced at Uber in implementing GDPR were it was just the massive operational scope. Mm-hmm. There's lots of data in lots of places, and getting your hands around all of that, doing the data flow audits, the data inventories, the privacy impact assessments, that's a big job. And then some of the specific requirements around things like consent can still be a real challenge. What was it at LinkedIn that was the biggest challenge for you? What did you find to be the biggest aha or like forehead slapper, like, gosh, we should have been thinking about this, or gosh, this is much harder than we thought it would be?
Yeah, well, we were fortunate at LinkedIn that we had already established a privacy program and had been building for some time a lot of the data subject right access in and some of the deletion requests. So some of that had already been built out. And I think what we used GDPR as an opportunity for was to really help the company understand that data privacy is not just a legal issue. This is an issue that needs to go throughout the company. And I think that's part of why we're here at RSA today having this conversation. conversation with a security crowd around privacy, because this issue is no longer something that just sits with the lawyers and the legal department, but is really something that everybody in the company has a responsibility for. And so that means that our engineers, our product designers, as well as our lawyers are sitting in the same room thinking through some of these issues and trying to think about how do we do privacy by design? How do we think through some of the ways in which we can eliminate data where we don't need it and design our products still with that member first thought, but without as much data?
So. All right, Kalinda, I'm going to ask you a question about one of two things, and what you don't answer, Ruby gets.
Oh,
ready?
I like
so
the
I
way
want
this
you
works.
To tell
good,
me,
Kalinda.
Nicer, Ruby.
So here are the two things. Tell me about either data subject access requests and how hard they are, or the right to be forgotten and how hard that is. Now, folks in the room, these both are components of the GDPR, and both operationally can be really challenging. So which one do you want to tell us about?
I will take DSRs for $100.
Okay, data subject access
requests. All right, so I think data subject access requests are a very fundamental part of the GDPR. What it does is it gives individuals the right to write out to companies and say, give me access to all the data you have about me. And in order to fulfill that, you really have to have a mapping of all your data across the company. And so what a lot of companies spent time doing leading up to GDPR was trying to figure out that inventory and then maintaining that inventory on a constant basis. And DSRs aren't something that are just going to be relevant to us as a result of GDPR, but as we'll discuss with CCPA, this is a right that's coming here in California as well. So it's something we're all going to have to be thinking about.
So I think there's a great point to raise here, especially for an information security audience, and that is many of the tools, many of the responses to GDPR are actually developing things that probably are useful for information security pros as well. If you're doing full-on maps of data in your organization, you're creating architecture that allows you to see it and touch it and manage it, that's probably something that helps information security pros in their risk mapping on this stuff as well.
Well, this is the nice way in which where privacy and security have really come together, and there's overlapping benefits to the things we all need. And this is why the relationship between the CPO and the CISO is even closer than it's been before, because the work that the CISO needs to do is a lot of what the CPO needs to play off of to get some of these rights met.
Interesting. All right, Ruby, Kalinda left you with the right to be forgotten.
Thanks a lot.
Congratulations.
She'll pay me back later.
Tell us about the right to be forgotten and how you've implemented or what you've learned about it as you've implemented it.
So I'm lucky that I'm not a content platform, but I will tell you the challenges anyway.
Okay.
So first of all, there's just the lens at which we look at right to be forgotten, right? So we Americans look at it and say, what about our First Amendment rights? Or if you're us, we say, but we want to be remembered. Not forgotten. So the challenge geographically is difficult because not everybody thinks it's a good thing. And then you have extraterritoriality problems where one jurisdiction will try to make the right to be forgotten go beyond their jurisdiction. If you're a web-based service, they're trying to cut you off everywhere that you're offering the content. So there's arguments over that. And then technologically, it can be difficult. I'm not sure how you claw back data that's gotten in the wild. Good luck with that. Any security professional would tell you data wants to be free. So there are a lot of challenges to that, and there are no really good answers.
Yeah, and I think it's fair to say that particularly with right to be forgotten, we are still seeing implementations and dialogue with the regulators about what expectations might exist. I know that there's even a case involving Google that's going up through the courts again, and we may see parameters emerge on that. Definitely the geographical limitations on right to be forgotten is something that needs to be considered. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the enforcement environment now. So the GDPR compliance deadline, May 25th, opened up the GDPR enforcement era. And arguably on May 26th, the various data protection authorities, each European Union country has a data protection authority, which is an independent regulator in that country. Most of them have a role of privacy commissioner or data protection commissioner, and their task is to enforce the GDPR. Under GDPR, most companies are able to assign themselves to a single regulator, although all 27 or 28 with the UK data protection authorities do have enforcement hooks that they can put put into organizations. But I think in the first 10 months, we saw very little in the way of enforcement, and that probably was to be expected. Those data protection authorities were ramping up the same way companies were ramping up. But notably, just this year, in the past few weeks, we've heard an announcement of a proposed fine of 50 million euros from the French regulator, the CNIL. And there is an expectation, I think, from most organizations that enforcement will increase and we'll see many more enforcement actions. Ruby, tell me how you are seeing that enforcement environment, and is that going to be really instructive and directional for us in terms of how we respond to GDPR in the future?
Yeah, I still think enforcement's a toddler, so we need to buckle our seatbelts to see what happens. But what I have noticed is a huge uptick in pure privacy plays in the enforcement, right? So for a while, every headline you read was about some massive data breach. Now, there's a lot of headlines about how the data is being managed, right? Data hygiene, yep. How is it collected, what it's being used for, and also, of course, how it's being shared, how it's getting out. So those are interesting because those things really are much more in your control than a hacker isn't causing any of that, right?
Right.
That's something that you're doing yourself with your data practices. And I think that hammer is going to continue to fall. And I think as the fines right now are still pretty low in Europe especially, and we'll see what happens because once those shoes start to fall, I think it starts a precedent and a ball rolling that we're going to see.
Interesting. Kalinda, tell me a little bit about how you and LinkedIn look at those enforcement actions, those advisories that come out from the data protection authorities. Is there like a common law of enforcement actions? Like, do those become quasi-regulation in a sense?
In a sense, they do, because at this point, to Ruby's point, we're still in the toddler stages of enforcement. And so how do we know how the GDPR is actually going to be interpreted and enforced in reality? One of the ways we can find that out best is by looking at what regulators are doing and what their decisions are around and how they're appointing fines according to that. So it really does help give a sense of what is considered to be the highest severity in terms of how they're interpreting the different fines that can be given under the GDPR.
Yeah, I think this is a great point and a great one for this audience to take back to their companies. Watch enforcement actions. Enforcement actions will be indicative of what the regulators care about. And so if they are talking about 72-hour notice periods for data breach, and you see a number of enforcement actions around that, well, your risk profile on notice of security breach, at least to the regulator, just went up pretty significantly. So watching those enforcement actions through the remainder of this year and into the future, I think is a really critical thing. Ruby, tell me about the executive response. One of the things about privacy over the years has been that it was often, an army of one inside an organization, some brave soul like yourself or Kalinda, waving the privacy flag, desperately trying to scrap for resources and attention. Has that changed because of GDPR?
Oh, I definitely think it's changed. So my sandwich board has gotten much smaller. Help. I definitely think it's been a game changer in terms of getting mind share, which is awesome because, frankly, I don't like spending my time justifying my existence every 2 minutes. And it's not that much different than sometimes the tops-down, view of compliance or lawyers in general, that kind of thing. Sometimes, a company has a different agitation towards it. But if you have the mind share from the time you stepped in the door, like I did at Uber for whatever reason, and we've had our mistakes, but new leadership. So when I showed up and the mind share was immediately already there, it allowed me to integrate faster than I believe I ever have in any new job I've had and hit the ground running on what my operations and changes and improvements were going to be. So I didn't have to waste time convincing everybody that we have to make changes. Everyone's like, thank God you're here. What are we going to do now? And that is just so much more efficient and so much more of a time saver than when you have to go around, with your pocketbook open all the time trying to get somebody to drop some change in there.
Kalinda, how about at LinkedIn?
I think GDPR has changed the landscape, but we have to look back a little bit further than even GDPR to see just how far the issue of privacy has come. So when I started in privacy back in the early 2000s, it was exactly what you mentioned, one person at a company, if you're lucky, because quite honestly, it was usually an outside counsel, advising, thinking about it as a quarter of their job. And I was at companies like Nintendo where we were bringing these issues to the C-suite, and the response was, well, it's not hurting other businesses to worry so much about privacy, so why is this a fundamental thing we should do? And then, you know, I think there have been a series of things that have come about. The Snowden revelations, I think the GDPR helped in bringing fines that really got attention at the C-suite level. And so I think that at LinkedIn, we've been very fortunate in that our C-suite has understood this concept from the beginning of the founding of the company, because in reality, our founders tried to do a dating site first and realized very quickly that trust mattered in how you get a network to grow. So I am very fortunate at LinkedIn in that I walked into a situation similar to Ruby's where there is a clear understanding of how this ties into our values. But I think it is something that many companies are just now beginning to get to the point mm-hmm. of recognizing that a privacy program is a necessity to any company moving forward in the next 5-10 years.
I think that's a great point. Clearly, there has been a shift in executive C-suite minds around privacy being very much connected to trust and safety and engagement, and that is ultimately good for business.
Right.
So that's a big thing. Great. Given that we have an information security audience, I want to come back to the 72-hour notice for security breaches, which is a requirement under GDPR. Talk to me about what the operational response looks like, Kalinda, inside LinkedIn. Like, what have you had to build and prepare for? What does the wargaming look like? Like, what does it look like? What kind of tabletop exercises are you doing to make sure that you're ready to really turn on a dime? Because 72 hours is not much
yes.
to get a notice out.
And, you know, really one of the greatest challenges in that 72-hour time frame, and I think this audience will really appreciate it, is figuring out if you have a data breach and then figuring out what's causing it in that short a period of time. So what it has done is it has taken the time frame in which a company has to explore an issue and really try to understand what's happening and shortened it. So now you're in the phase of trying to figure out exactly what happened, how many were impacted, what was going on, and you've also got a plan for your regulatory response and your member output. So I think 72 hours is I think any of us who have dealt with data breaches know that when you're in it, it's 24 hours, not nonstop, and you don't really take a break anyhow. Right. I think the added pressure of the 72 hours is you've got to get everybody in the company to understand our clock starts ticking the minute someone in the company knows. Wow. So it doesn't matter that whether or not the CISO didn't know or whether Ruby and I didn't know, our clock starts ticking. And so to operationalize that as a company, what we have done is really try to get the training out there, the communication around this is the one alias you want to write to when you think you've got a situation. And that has helped because we have a tremendous number of employees who are very conscious of that email address and how quick that time frame has to be if they're going to alert us to something.
You almost need like another pull handle next to the fire alarm on the wall.
A data breach alarm.
Well,
you kind of do if you're going to organize it within a company, you really do have to have ahead of time the plan in place as to who gets called, what are you going to do when that happens.
So Ruby, talk to us about data breach being a place where information security and privacy professionals meet and work, because I have to imagine in all of the systems that Kalinda just described, which I'm expecting Uber has comparable systems in place, that your dialogue with your information security colleagues is pretty critical in those places.
It's very critical. Well, that and more, right? I mean, data breaches are just one, or you know, incidents, even it doesn't even have to be a breach, just some kind of incident. It's a very important part of the relationship, but it's only part of it. But it's one of the most important parts because you do want to keep the data secure. So, I mean, I talk to my wonderful CISO every single week. We have a one-on-one, and of course, we may talk in between. We're in other safety or risk-based meetings together as well, and we're in governance meetings. We went to the board together. We are truly thing one and thing two, and it's essential because I need to understand more about the technology of this company, how it works, and what he's doing, and he needs to understand more about the guardrails that I'm trying to put in place. And I have a former CISO who talks about magnets. When you are working together, there's a lot of stickiness to what you're doing. When you're working alone, there's a lot of polarization, and it doesn't really help people. So It's just, again, I was born to be an efficient person. I don't know what this is about. Like,
sorry, I lost my train of thought because I'm thinking of you and your CISO in those red pajamas with like
thing one and thing two
on you.
All right, I'm more of a thing. Actually a very nice, calm man. One person needs excitement disorder. But honestly, working well together is very important.
Again, I think for information security pros in the audience, this is a place and a good dialogue for you to make sure that you're having. Make sure that you know your privacy team. Make sure that you're engaged with that operational response to data breach under GDPR. It's a great connection point. And I think as Ruby has demonstrated, there's all sorts of other things that you should be talking about and can be talking about. But notice of security breach is a great connection point to make those magnets stick together.
Well, and the documents need to refer to each other too, right? So
sure.
If you have privacy incident management and security incident management, those two have to really fit together.
Got it.
And the processes have to meld.
Kalinda, let's stay in Europe for a second and just touch briefly on the complexity of Brexit. Now, we don't know a lot about this right now, and I just want you to give us sort of two or three bullet points as to what we should be thinking about. But I think it's March 29th is the go-no-go date on a deal for Brexit, and when the UK will arguably be stepping out of the European Union. Tell us what, from an information and data transfer and data governance perspective, organizations should be thinking about, and for example, what LinkedIn is paying attention to with regards to Brexit.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think Brexit is a really difficult issue for anyone sitting in Europe right now to try to figure out what next steps are, mainly because it's so uncertain from a political landscape. But I think what's key for companies to keep in mind from a tech standpoint is how are you going to manage with a country that's no longer in the same realm as GDPR? So what does that mean for the UK? What does that mean for your relationship with any entities you have sitting in the UK? And I think our main establishment sits in Ireland, but I think for any company that's established in the UK, this is a significant point of consideration right now. As well as you've got to think through your contracts. And now if the UK is not considered part of the EU, well, does a transfer of data to the UK now count as a transfer outside of the EU? And so these are some of the complexities that those of us in legal are really trying to think through.
Just to draw that one to a close, data transfers outside of the European Union under GDPR require some mechanism that allows for the transfer.
Right.
So you either have to be transferring to a country that has been blessed by the European Union or have some other mechanism that they have recognized for purposes of that transfer. And of course, if the UK goes outside of the European Union, all of a sudden transfers become an issue.
Yep.
In and out, intra-company and outside the company.
Yep.
Exactly. So Ruby, anything to add to Kalinda's list on Brexit messes that we're going to have to deal with?
I think those are the key ones, but I think the question is, what do you do about it? And I think what you should do is continue following the GDPR guidance, follow the ICO guidance, which is the UK Data Protection Authority. They offer super practical little guidelines on their site. They're really easy to understand.
Yep.
So that at least you're as well positioned as you can be and pay attention to your data transfer scheme.
I think that's a really good tip for this audience. If you're worried about Brexit at all, you're wondering about the data security or data privacy issues associated with Brexit, the website of the Information Commissioner of the UK, the ICO, the Information Commissioner's Office, you can find it online quickly, is a really great resource, and they're producing massive amounts of materials for companies. All right, I want to remind our audience that you have the ability to ask questions. I think I can barely see the microphones, and no one is standing there, and you'll hurt our feelings if you don't ask questions at some point.
You don't want to hurt our feelings. Come on.
So, looks like we might have a question coming up. So why don't we go right to that question? Hi.
Yeah, for both of you in Uber and LinkedIn, when you had the change management internally, the awareness for all the employees about the GDPR and how they need to communicate information that doesn't include any GDPR or doesn't object with all the GDPR policies that need to be applied, what kind of change management you followed to make that available?
Great. So I'm just going to restate questions once they come in. Great question, by the way. And that was, look, it's one thing for your privacy team to be managing GDPR, but GDPR is an enterprise-wide phenomenon. How did you communicate to employees, manage change for all of those employees, and sort of get the entire organization to move into a GDPR reality? Who wants to go first?
I can take that. Okay. So at LinkedIn, we started the planning for GDPR 2 years prior. And really, the first step that we had was in educating our C-suite about it to understand what the law was and what its implications were going to be and what we were going to need to do to get there. And then I think what flowed from there was really just an opportunity for us to continue to reiterate to our employee base our culture of privacy, which is based around our corporate principles. And so some of those principles, for example, is our members first approach. So when we're thinking about how we handle data, what we were able to share with employee base was our principle of members first applies to data as well. And so we think about our members when we are handling their data. And so what we really made an effort to do, we did several trainings. We did a video that featured our CEO, Jeff Weiner, talking about his experiences online and his experiences with data privacy, and several of our C-suite leaders talking to employees, not about GDPR, but about our culture of privacy and why we would continue to preserve that, and some of the ways in which that tied into our principles.
I think that's a great change management map. Executive support, tie it to your principles, and train like crazy. Clearly, with regards to GDPR, privacy awareness, those sorts of things, making sure that your employees understand that they are the weakest link in the chain. When they make a mistake with data, that is a privacy issue for your organization. Ruby, anything significantly different at Uber, or did it follow a similar pattern?
So I was at Intel at the time, which followed that pattern very closely. The interesting thing about Uber, I think, is that they had a very broad scope of people already in there helping, right?
Yep.
And, which work with me all the time now. We have comms people who work with me all the time, policy people, engineers on the platform side, product people who are thinking about how to make the app a better experience for users, so what kind of features we should build in. They're not legally required, but what would you like for your privacy today, Trevor? And we try things out and see how they go. And so we have this broad team of people already in place to help. And so that was essential in operationalizing the GDPR.
I like it. All right, we're going to take this question, and then we're going to talk about California and the California Consumer Privacy Act. Go ahead.
Hi. I work for a community college, and this question is about the right to be forgotten. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we've wondered about is, say, we have a lot of international students, and we get bigger funding for them, so we like them. But but somebody graduates, and then they request to be forgotten, and then years later, oh, can I get my transcript? And you know, our whole model is to save data, not delete it. So it's, and we're not even sure we have a mechanism to do that.
Yeah, so
how that might work.
So it's a very good question, and let me see if I can put a bow on this. And if you guys have something to add, let us know. The right to be forgotten has specific limitations associated with it. So there may be situations like transcripts where an archival record is completely permissible to maintain in perpetuity, frankly. And things like business records. Someone buys something from you as a business have a reasonable and legitimate interest in maintaining that record for a reasonable amount of time. And so the right to be forgotten definitely recognizes those types of interests, and you definitely should seek out the help of a privacy lawyer, privacy expertise, to make sure that you are sort of on the right side of GDPR if you have international students and it applies for data that was created here, for activities here. Even if it's an international student, it may still not be in effect. Anything to add?
Yeah, I would just chime on to that. I think you're absolutely right. That's a tricky issue, and you really have to look at what is your obligation of deletion under GDPR for European mm-hmm. students, and then determine whether there would be an exception when you're dealing with something like transcripts.
Yeah, there's a difference between right to be forgotten and account deletion.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Look, I have an economics class that I would love to forget from college.
Your grade is going to always be the same.
Exactly. All right. I will come back to the microphones in just one sec, but I want to raise a new topic, and I want to make sure we have enough time to talk about it. So we are in the city where it happened, the city where the CCPA was born, the creation myth. I'll tell it to you really quickly. Around the CCPA, the California Consumer Privacy Act, is a local real estate developer named Alistair McTaggart, based here in San Francisco, was at a party. He was talking to an engineer from a Bay Area tech company, and just jokingly, this real estate developer said to this engineer at a cocktail party while standing at a bar, drinking a beer, said, "Wow, you guys must know a lot about us, right?" And apparently the engineer said, "You have no idea." And from that moment, now I might have embellished a bit, but the facts are largely the same. It's been dramatized for purposes today, but the facts are largely the same. Alistair McTaggart was motivated to hire some privacy lawyers, some privacy advocates, draft a bill, and start a citizen referendum to get on the ballot in California. And this was early in 2018. He was failing miserably in that effort. He did not have enough signatures to get his privacy bill onto the California ballot last year. And then Cambridge Analytica happened. As a result, he got more than enough signatures, and it looked very much like at the time of the election that citizen referendum would actually pass, that ballot initiative would pass. And so in May, June of last year, in the course of 72 hours, industry came to Alistair McTaggart and worked with the Sacramento legislature and said, better a bill that we can pass and understand now than a citizen referendum in the fall that we can't predict and is way more difficult. And so in 72 hours, industry and Alistair McTaggart and the California legislature passed unanimously in both houses in Sacramento, signed by Jerry Berman, the most restrictive privacy law in the entire United States, the California Consumer Privacy Act. Now, the CCPA goes into effect January of next year. The IAPP held a workshop on CCPA Monday of this week here at RSA. We are beginning to educate our members all around the country and, in fact, around the world. Like the GDPR, it has something of an extraterritorial effect. And that is creating some real challenges for organizations, I think, in the United States. So why don't we start with Ruby? Tell us how Uber is looking at CCPA. Have you begun your preparations? Are you taking a wait-and-see approach? What is your posture with regards to CCPA?
We are not taking a wait-and-see approach. It's here. It's not going to change very much, in my opinion, unless it's to get more onerous for businesses. So you really should start prepping now. And no, it is not exactly the same as GDPR. There are GDPR elements in it, but it goes beyond that in some ways, like this, in confusing ways. Like, I don't even know what household data is, and I don't really know why I need it if every individual in the household already has their personal information protected. So there are a lot of ambiguities with it. There are elements that are contradictory. If you want to, you can go read Professor Eric Goldman from Santa Clara University's blogs on it, or Lothar Detterman's open letter to an assemblyman about it. They spell it all out very clearly. That these people are privacy advocates, by the way. We all are privacy advocates, but we have a problem trying to interpret it. That said, that's not an excuse not to start preparing for the things that are very clear and that you're going to need to do.
All right, so this is a really important point. I want all of you to go back to your companies next week, and I want you to go find your privacy person, your chief privacy officer, your head privacy lawyer, and I want you to ask them about the California Consumer Privacy Act. And if they say, hey, we've done GDPR, we're good, you kick them in the shins and say, that's from Ruby, right?
It's give not the them same. A nice shot glass filled with a brown liquid there and say, this is from Ruby.
No, the fact is CCPA is not GDPR, and it is different. There certainly are things that you've probably built for GDPR that will be helpful, yes. But CCPA deserves its own attention. Kalinda, do you agree?
Absolutely. If you're not already started, now is the time. GDPR is not the same as CCPA. I think what we are seeing a trend towards after GDPR, though, is a GDPRization of laws across the world. Mm. So Brazil has a new law that's coming into effect at around the same time as CCPA. It borrows from the GDPR. CCPA borrows the concept of data subject rights from GDPR. You look to India, and there was a bill that was recently considered in front of Parliament that has a lot of elements of GDPR. And so one of the things that's really hard for privacy professionals, and why don't kick them but give them a nice drink from Ruby, is the fact that we are looking at what is quickly becoming a bit of a patchwork of laws across the world that all have similar threads, but are different in various ways. And it reminds me very much of what's happened here in the US with a patchwork of data privacy laws, as well as 50 different state data breach laws. And so the challenge for anyone working in this space is to figure out what that highest bar is and how you will comply with it, and then to figure out those differences that Ruby's raising, and how are you going to operationalize that on a global scale?
I think that's a great point. Let's go to our next question.
I was wondering if someone from a European country sends an email to an American company, does the data, the right to be forgotten, apply to the contents of that email?
All right, we're getting to stump the band here. So the answer is it depends, I think, and it will be interesting to hear Kalinda and Ruby on this. It really does depend. Do you have an existing relationship with that customer? Are you doing business in Europe? Is this a one-off circumstance? There's probably a number of facts and factors that would play into this. And like anything, seek some legal advice from a competent privacy attorney. Kalinda, Ruby?
The only thing I want to add is, and Ruby was alluding to this before, is that the right to be forgotten almost has two branches to it within the GDPR.
Yep.
So there is the piece around deletion and what has to be deleted. And this is where we were going to before with the previous question is, not only is there exceptions when there's a business reason or some other reason to retain things, and this is why your advice of a lawyer is very helpful. So that deletion right is not absolute. And then the other hand of it is what is traditionally thought of as right to be forgotten, which was part of a Google case from several years ago, where someone wanted the attachment of their name to certain data that was coming up in search terms to be cut off and deleted. So there are two ways to think about the right to be forgotten, and you're particularly talking about the deletion right, and there are exceptions to that.
Thank you. All right. Let's turn to the broader U.S. landscape, because with CCPA, we have seen a renewed interest in additional privacy laws at the state level, and then more broadly, federal privacy law at a federal level. And I will note that just last night, Washington Bill SB 5376 passed 46-1 in the Washington Senate. They couldn't quite get unanimous, didn't quite do as well as California, but Washington State had a really good showing for a privacy bill, and that is now on to the House of Representatives in Washington, and we may very well see by the end of this week a Washington privacy bill signed into law by the governor. Talk to me a little bit, Ruby, about the broader privacy legislative environment that we see and what you're looking for, what you're expecting this year.
It's becoming less and less harmonized, which is making it more and more difficult. I have no problem with GDPR, but when each state decides it will take certain elements and not certain elements, and then, you know, some are elements from somewhere else, that's a problem. And it's not just now the data breach notification laws. It's a bunch of other things that you're trying to comply with. This is now going down to the municipality level. Can you imagine every municipality having different rules for you?
Wow.
So we need some guidance that will help solidify a common approach to this, because it's quickly going to become unworkable for companies. And there are already outcries that small to medium-sized businesses aren't going to be able to have the resources to figure this out.
Kalinda.
I absolutely agree with Ruby. I think where we're going to end up and need to eventually get to is to federal legislation here in the United States around data privacy. I think having two conflicting laws, if Washington were to pass, so California and Washington, is just going to make it clearer how much we need to have harmony across the U.S. And if we do end up with federal legislation, it would need to preempt our state laws, but it also needs to incorporate the existing patchwork of privacy laws we have today here in the U.S. So unlike Europe, which has taken the approach of the GDPR, a general data protection approach, here in the U.S., we have laws that are different around your financial privacy, your healthcare privacy, your children's privacy, your video viewing rights privacy, and all of these need to be taken into account if we get federal legislation. So I think the goal for most of us is that our lives will be a lot easier if we do have a federal law. The question is, how long will it take to get there?
So, speed round. What is your percentage chance that we will have a federal privacy bill passed this year? Ruby.
So I keep giving the highest percentages in order to give people hope.
Okay.
So today I'm going to say it's 30%.
30%. Kalinda?
Yes, and I'm the opposite side of that because I think minus 10%. I think the reason I say that in this year is that I think it's a real challenge to pull together where we are in Congress today to say that we're going to get something passed. But I hope that Ruby's the one who's right here.
So 30% and 10% chance for federal legislation. I will note that Julie Brill from Microsoft was in a session earlier this week, and she put her percentage at 30%
too. She did.
Too. So well done. Let's go to one last question. Go ahead. Yes, please.
Kalinda,
come on right close to the microphone, please.
I'd like to bring your awareness. Myself have dual citizenship. A lot of UK nationals, they also have a dual citizenship. They are UK citizen as well as EU citizen. Mm-hmm. No matter UK is going to successful exit EU, GDPR still a regulation to be compliant. However, in my humble opinion, CCPA is more defined. We Americans like to follow our American thing, so.
So I'm not sure if there's a question there, and I want to make sure I understood, but let me see if I can repackage that a bit. I think there's a lot of complexity associated with many of the factors in modern societies. Things like citizenship, things like immigration, things like where you happen to be at a certain time, and also the global nature of the information economy. You know, I can buy something off of an Indonesian website this afternoon and have it shipped to my house. And does that mean all of a sudden that I am subject to Indonesian privacy law, or organizations are required to apply Indonesian privacy law to me? It makes for a very complex environment, doesn't it?
Yes, it really does. I mean, that's one of the real difficulties of the internet and data privacy is it is a global thing. And how do you figure out how to navigate those different laws amongst different countries?
I think that's right. Okay, time for the big close. There has been reporting in the Wall Street Journal and the Washington Post that the FTC is negotiating a settlement of a privacy enforcement action with Facebook, which may go as high as $4 or $5 billion with a B dollars, an enforcement action at $4 to $5 billion, as reported by the Wall Street Journal and the Washington Post. Now, whether that actually ever sees the light of day, whether it's negotiated down, who knows? But it seems like there is a moment right now that there is a moment where privacy is being recognized at the very highest levels. I will note in the San Francisco Chronicle this morning, Mark Zuckerberg promises to emphasize privacy was the headline in the business section after an essay by Mark Zuckerberg was published yesterday about a new strategic approach for Facebook, which involves greater privacy protections for their users and customers. Is all of this a game changer? Is the enforcement actions, the attention, the broad media focus that we have seen on privacy, is it a real game changer for us in privacy? Is it really changing the nature of the debate? Or is this just sort of a passing fad that we'll get over and things will go back to normal sometime soon? Ruby, why don't you start?
I will start, and I will say, is data a passing fad?
No, I asked the question, Ruby.
No, it's not a passing fad. And I think what happens if someone gets a large fine is, as I said earlier, it's going to start the ball rolling for more. I think the biggest problem is a lack of transparency right now. And, you know, there was a Google fine based almost purely on a lack of transparency. People don't like that they don't understand what's happening with their data. That's where the politicians are all arriving. You know, what's happening with my data? And until we fix that problem, where at least people understand the benefit of the bargain and whether or not they like the benefit of the bargain, we're going to keep seeing this.
So Ruby's told us that the fundamental nature of the lack of transparency and the structure that we have of data in the marketplace today can create these challenges. Kalinda, talk to me about the awareness at board and executive levels inside your organization. I have to imagine that their heads snap back and they pay attention when they see these kind of fines.
You know, I think that it depends on the company, quite honestly. I think at LinkedIn, as I mentioned, we already have kind of the building ground for that culture of privacy amongst our CEOs. But I do think that having done privacy for a long time, I am seeing a sea shift happening. And I think it's absolutely natural to the development of the internet. If you think about it, the internet has only been commercialized for the past 20 plus years. It's not been very long. And during that time, a lot of data has been collected, and it's truly been a social experiment in terms of all of us thinking, what does that mean for our data to be collected? And we've all slowly crept to getting more comfortable buying everything online, doing things like filing for our driver's license online and for things we wouldn't have thought of 20 years ago. So I think the fact that we are now getting to a point where society is discussing data privacy and it's continuing to grow as an area where there's a recognition we might need more regulation and oversight is a natural outcome of where we are in terms of the development of the internet.
I think these are both great answers. Let me give my answer, and that is, I think absolutely, we are in a different era. We are in a new era where privacy is being recognized as a critical societal interest. And I think what we need to convey to chief executives, to boards, to companies, is that this is not just a checkbox compliance exercise. This is hard work that takes professionals working consistently over time to make it right. And if there's anything that I take comfort in, it's that that hard work is being done by great leaders like these two women who are sitting next to me. So I hope you'll join me in thanking them for a great panel and great work.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. And we're done. Well done.